And welcome to Museums Under the Spotlight. I am Alina Dima, your host, and today I would love to invite you to take a trip in the past through the sound of music. You will hear the magical sound of the violin and the piano and learn more about the extraordinary life and compositions of Romania's most famous composer, George Enescu. We will follow his footsteps and learn more about this violin genius in a museum dedicated to him, the George Enescu Museum, right here in the center of Bucharest, the beautiful capital of Romania.
The National Museum George Enescu was opened in the Cantacuzino Palace, one of the most beautiful buildings in Bucharest, a historical monument and one of the European Heritage Label buildings. The sumptuous entrance in Art Nouveau style announced the luxury and the refinement of the epoch, reunited in one of the most imposing palaces in Bucharest. The permanent exhibition of the museum includes three rooms of the palace displaying photographs, manuscripts, various documents, diplomas, medals, drawings, sculptures, musical instruments, costumes, furniture, decorative art and personal objects.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we are in this spectacular palace that hosts the George Enescu Museum here in Bucharest, and we are going to find out more stories and even listen to the sounds of the great composer. So, together with our wonderful host, Liliana Bârnat, we are going to find out more about George Enescu's life and compositions. Hello, and thank you so much for having us here today. I was wondering, what is the story behind the foundation of the museum?
The museum, as you said, is here in the Cantacuzino Palace. At first, the building was finished at the beginning of the 20th century, and the owner of the palace had no connection with George Enescu at first. Actually, the building became a museum dedicated to him through his wife, Maria Cantacuzino. As you can see, she also had the name Cantacuzino because she was the daughter-in-law of the owner of the palace. It is actually an exquisite building with great decorations, a great architecture, and also you can see details of sculpture and decorations. In many of the details of the palace, we can see the double C representing the family, Cantacuzino family.
So, since we were talking about the building and the history of the family, I am really curious to find out some more details about the Cantacuzino family and about the style, the architectural style of the building that hosts the museum. So, let's develop on that.
Well, Grigore Cantacuzino, the owner of the palace, was a very important political man. He was actually mayor of Bucharest at some point, also a minister of the Conservative Party. And he chose this place, which was at the time at the border, let's say, of the Bucharest, in order to, let's say, show how much money he had. He came from the very famous Cantacuzino family, which actually came from the old Byzantium, so the inheritance of the family was quite great. He began to build this palace. He chose as an architect a very young Romanian one, Ioan Berindei. Actually, by this he tried to sustain the young artists, not only the architect but also the painters and the sculptors.
So when was the time that George Enescu inherited, let's say, this building, or what is the connection exactly?
I don't think he was actually in the papers, an official owner of the palace. He became an owner by the marriage with Maria Cantacuzino in 1937. But they didn't actually stay here. Enescu already had a house in Paris, and Marocca followed him actually there, and also in many of his tours in Europe and in all over the world. But the museum became a museum after Enescu's death through a donation act made by Marocca in 1956.
George Enescu is one of the most praised European composers, but in order to understand his creation, we have to go back to the roots and understand the exact journey that made of George Enescu one of the most important composers in history. So, coming to the roots, how was George Enescu's childhood, and what was the journey that made him become one of the most famous composers?
His childhood, I think, was something very special. First of all, because he had a special relationship with his parents, which actually helped him a lot, morally and financially, of course. At only 5 years old, he left Romania with a nanny, but still, it was something very hard to imagine. First, he went to Vienna, and afterwards to Paris.
So, how did his first encounter with music actually take place?
That happened actually when he was still in Romania, born in a small village in northern Moldavia. He listened to some fiddlers playing violin and some other instruments, but the violin was the most impressive for him. Actually, he asked for a violin so that he could try to play himself. We have it in the exhibition, and it's quite touching to see just a small violin. Afterwards, he went to Iași, which was at the time the capital of Moldavia. And the teacher there recommended that he should go somewhere abroad to study. So the parents made this decision, a very hard one. And it's quite interesting to see how Enescu kept in touch with his parents, and they wrote letters one to another, and to see his handwriting, not only as a composer, but also in letters. He already started composing, of course, very easy pieces for piano mostly, and some for violin, of course, because that was the instrument that he preferred. At 17 years old, his very first opus was Poème Roumain, which was actually presented in public. And also an interesting thing is that in Romania, in March 1898, he conducted himself this piece at the Romanian Ateneum.
And it is a trademark also for Romania, yes. And for Bucharest, the capital of Romania.
Yes,
and
yes.
I believe that it is the actual house of the George Enescu Philharmonic.
Yes, yes. I think it's not a coincidence that the Philharmonic has the name of George Enescu, because Enescu himself made great efforts for the Ateneum, for the cultural society that was founded in the Ateneum, and also he contributed financially to the installation of the organ in the concert hall of the Ateneum.
So we can definitely say that even from his from a young age, George Enescu was a true prodigy and a musical genius. Symbolic edifice, the heart of the Romanian culture, the Romanian Athenaeum, built in the center of Bucharest over 120 years ago, has become an architectural and spiritual landmark of a whole nation, not just of the capital city. The Athenaeum was the starting place of George Enescu's career as a musician. It has been for over half a century the house of the George Enescu Philharmonic, and ever since 1958, it is the headquarters of the George Enescu International Music Festival, one of the most famous music festivals in the world. Royalty and the royal family here in Romania played a very, very important role in the cultural life in Romania and in Bucharest. And not only that, but supported young artists to go beyond the Romanian borders. And this is what happened to George Enescu also. But we can find out what was the relationship between George Enescu, the composer, and the royal family.
Well, actually, it was a relation not only between George Enescu as a composer, but also as a violin or piano player. He drew the attention of the royal family, firstly with the poem Romain, which ended in Enescu's orchestral vision with the royal anthem. Certainly, the king and the queen were amazed about that. Actually, it is said that King Mihai the First liked to listen that part orchestrated by Enescu. So, at the end of the 19th century and beginning of the 20th, Enescu was already invited in the Peleș Castle in Sinaia. Mostly as a violin player. He gave their recitals for the Queen.
I know that Queen Elizabeth had a talent as a poetess also. Yes. So there is a really special connection between the Queen and her artistic side and George Enescu. What is that?
In time they became very close. And Enescu received from the Queen some of her lyrics in German, and Enescu transposed those in music. And there are a cycle of 14 songs on Carmen Silva lyrics. They are quite nice, actually.
George Enescu was decorated many times by the royal family for his work and activity, but also the Romanian Academy thought that a musician should also be received as a member. So Enescu was the first one to become a member of the Academy. He held a speech during his first ceremony, and he also had meetings with the president of the Academy. George Enescu was very proud to be a member of this highly praised institute in Romania, because even though he was also a member in some other French institutes, this distinction was a question of patriotic feeling.
Every genius has a muse or a source of inspiration. And when you are a violinist, a pianist, a composer and a director, you definitely need many sources of inspiration. So I was wondering, what were George Enescu's sources of inspiration?
Well, first of all, it was the fiddler's music, which is quite improvisatoric music, let's say, and has a bit of connection of folklore music, but they are quite different. And Enescu made this difference between what is purely improvisation and what is folklore music, especially in the melody and secondary in the harmony of the piece. Afterwards, the Byzantine church music was also something that influenced him a lot. And as I said, also the sounds of nature, and using some specific instruments for that made him be, let's say, a composer that combined many musical styles. And Enescu actually even played with some of his students. And we can mention here the name of Yehudi Menuhin. He became Enescu's favorite student. They started as teacher and student in America. Enescu teaching Menuhin how to master his skills in violin playing. And in the end, they actually recorded together the double concerto of Bach, which received a Grand Prix de Disque for the exceptional recording.
Menuhin, let's be honest, is definitely one of the best violinists in the world.
Yes.
But having such a teacher, you cannot be otherwise.
Well, yes, that's true.
So George Enescu was also a great professor, not only a composer.
Yes.
and the violinist and pianist. So he had a very complex personality.
Yes, he had.
We talked about George Enescu's compositions and artistic genius, but apart from that, we know very little, maybe, about George Enescu, the man, and his private life. So we are now here in his private residence behind the Cantacuzino Palace, and together with our host, we are going to find out some interesting details regarding his private life.
Well, Enescu, as we mentioned, was a very modest man. As you can see, the house in which he actually stayed when he was in Bucharest is much smaller than the palace, and very little decorated. And also his room looks like a monk, actually, a monk room. Very small, not too many things. Actually, all he needed was a few scores, a few pages of manuscripts, and of course the violin, because it was something that was always with him. Here we can see a piano, because we are actually in the music hall of the small house. It's very small and let's say just for private meetings with friends. And I think it was very nice that Enescu had a musical gathering with some friends, and they just met and played and talked about what they have done in the latest time, and probably exchange impressions about what other composers did, or maybe.
And how about his life with the wife, with Maria or Maruca? What's their love story? How did it all begin?
Their love story is quite a story. They first met on the alleys of Peles Castle. So the royal family had a great influence on Enescu.
So they played Cupid for them.
Something like that. So we could say Enescu was a gentleman. He didn't want to interfere on Maruca's marriage. She was married to the son of Gheorghe Grigore Cantacuzino, even though she had affairs aside the marriage. But Enescu didn't want to be just, let's say, the mistress.
Or another affair.
Exactly. So they got married almost 20 years later. And they finally made it official. And afterwards, Maruca followed Enescu almost everywhere he went. The proof that their love story was very strong is that after Enescu died, she donated the palace and the house to become a museum dedicated to him. I think this is very important. In the end, that's all that matters for us now in the present. The fact that we have a museum in the heart of Bucharest, a house that wasn't actually Enescu's. So I think that's the very proof of how much Maruca loved him.
Yes, and the proof of their love story. And
yes,
most likely she was also a muse for him.
Yes,
she was. Actually, Enescu dedicated one of his masterpieces, the opera Oedipe, to her wife, his wife. Part of the score was written in Tuscany, which was a favorite place for Enescu because it reminded him of his childhood, of his surroundings in nature and so on.
I always wanted to play the piano, but I have no talent whatsoever. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I hope you have enjoyed the stories, the music, and the beauty behind George Enescu's life and musical masterpieces. The museum dedicated to this famous composer can offer you a wonderful experience, full of delicacy and wonder, and it can take you for a few moments in a different time frame to understand exactly how life was lived in those times. So I believe that it is reason enough for you to pay it a visit. Until next time, remember to make your life a beautiful story.